So maybe another one. I already wrote her that we can get her. Yes, we can start.
Hello, good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's session on contributed oral presentation. I'm really happy to invite Catherine Hall for her first presentation here today. Hello, Catherine. Good evening. I guess it's evening there. Are you able to hear us, Catherine?
I'm online. I can hear you.
Okay, Catherine.
Catherine might not have her audio turned on.
Okay, she's not able to hear. Now, are you able? No, even we cannot hear her.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Perfect. Yes. Yes. Can you hear us now?
I hear you now.
Oh, great. Superb.
Maybe it was
No worries. Welcome to the session, Catherine. I guess it's evening there. So good evening.
Good evening. The end of the week. What a week.
So you are able to hear us properly, right? Super. So yeah. I guess you can go ahead with sharing your screen and you can start your presentation, please.
Thank you. Here we go. Thank you. Hi, Jeff. So, good morning, good evening. Thanks so much for choosing to come to hear about the Australian Reference Genome Atlas. It's lovely to be able to be here and tell you about our project. At the moment, our project is starting out, and so there's no great results as such to show you yet. But what I would like to achieve today, and now that I've got your ears this morning, is just to let you know the approach that we're taking and why we're doing it. And hopefully you'll see that what we're hoping to do is leverage a lot of the great work that Chadwick has been doing in terms of standards, and particularly with Darwin Core, that we'll be using as we go through the journey now of starting to build the actual reference atlas itself. And so as I explain this to you, I suppose the first thing that I want to address is, well, why on earth are we even doing this in the first place? And, what's it all about? So why would we even begin this journey of trying to create a genome atlas? And the first thing that I'd like to ask you all to do is just to, one, have a look at this beautiful picture of an ant and think about ants for a little while, and imagine that we are ants and think about the things that ants do. And what I suppose when I think about ants, what I think about is that they're always busy and active and out there looking for things. And so what ethnologists know is that ants do a lot of different things in terms of trying to find food sources. And they may use chemical cues, they may talk to one another with pheromone trails, and they may also do a lot of other things like the great word there, which I found, which is idiothetic cues. They might use those, which means that basically they're self-generating their own searching strategies. And as we've been out and about talking to people, we've been trying to learn which of these ant-like strategies they use for trying to find genomics data. Now, the other thing about this is, why on earth do we care so much about genomics data? What's so special about it? Why is this something that's currently an imperative? Well, for us here in Australia, and I think it's pretty fair to say it's a similar situation internationally, the government has recognised that high-throughput sequencing in particular and the increasing speed with which we're generating genomics data is something that represents a sort of critical technology for our prosperity into the future. So for Australia, it's been identified as something of high national interest in terms of our economic growth into the future, as well as our security for biosecurity purposes and also disease preparedness. Now, genomics data interact across a number of sectors where there are researchers. Chief among them is healthcare and medical. And though we mightn't be focusing on human aspects with this project, we certainly will be involving ourselves with vectors and pathogens and other things around that space. Also, it's important in terms of agriculture, just the environment, conservation and things like that, as well as defence and the production of energy, as more and more microbial organisms are identified as being useful in the energy chain and for making sure that pollutants and that type of thing are recycled. So what we also know is that when policy is created using data, then it becomes stronger and it's able to be more responsive. It's not necessarily just waiting for a disaster to happen before we can answer questions. In Australia, environmental concerns are very important. At the moment, it is raining buckets in Brisbane, where I am, and it's also been flooding in the south of the country. And you may remember a couple of years ago, Australia was on fire. So, we're a country of great environmental extremes. And what we hope is that in using some genetic data, we're able to become more proactive in terms of how we manage these risks and threats into the future. Now, there's an organisation in Australia called the Australian Biocommons that works across the research space for genomics research with researchers, and they've done some survey work and they've found out that there are approximately 15,000 life scientists currently working in Australia who are interacting with genomics data in some sort of way to help them answer big questions in research. Unfortunately, though, often these researchers, instead of looking very happy at their machines, end up looking like this, because what we're finding increasingly is that genomics data are not just all the same, and that whilst previously they may have been visible from some sources, increasingly they're becoming hidden as they become attachments on publications. They're lost in supplementary files, popped into things like Dryad, and disappear from being easily able to be found. They're also very complex. They're very nested in their structures. And this is becoming quite a big problem. And they're also not connected very well with other informatics services in terms of being able to be readily available and interoperable for analysis. So you might say, but hang on a minute, we've heard about this thing called GenBank. Everyone knows GenBank is out there, it exists, and it's really good. And you know, everyone uses it, everyone puts their stuff into GenBank, you get an accession number, you put it in your publication, and the job is done. So people should be able to go to GenBank and find what they're looking for. Would that that were true. Unfortunately, increasingly, GenBank is becoming very, very large, and it's becoming very hard for researchers to actually pinpoint the exact pieces of information that they want to get out of GenBank easily. And so searching is very time consuming for them. GenBank is currently very old. It's 40 years old this year, and it's grown quite a lot in that time. You can see from the image there, in 1986, 1987, it was published in actual books. Now it's online. We can all go and have a look at it. But the size of it is absolutely enormous. It's getting close to just being, for normal Sanger sequencing data, close to 1.5 trillion bases or beyond that. And then now that whole genome sequencing is becoming increasingly popular and easily accessed by labs, and data are increasing in their rate of production, it's getting up to being altogether, you know, beyond 20 trillion bases within these databases. So very, very big. The other thing about GenBank is that for a long time, although things have tightened up with GenBank a lot recently, but for a very long time, the acceptance standard for getting your data into GenBank relied more on the annotation of the gene rather than the accuracy of any of the taxonomic assignments that were designated for the taxa. And not only that, there was no peer review or third-party assessment of whether or not these identifications were accurate. And so because of that, people don't know when they come to GenBank if it's an old record, if it's any good or not. And so I just want to show you here just very quickly the rate at which data are increasing within GenBank. And so it makes it something that becomes a very pressing problem that we need to start to begin to make inroads into improving for researchers. It's only going to get bigger as time goes on, and people are just out there right now generating data. So we thought we'd have a look very quickly at where researchers were interacting with data and what types of data they were interacting with, to have an understanding of the sort of nestedness of their data sources. And we found that with life sciences researchers, they're using two types of data primarily. Those are the high fidelity reads that come from Sanger sequencing, as well as the new next gen sequencing technologies. And these next gen sequencing technologies are also being used and leveraged a lot by industry for breeding purposes and for also understanding populations as they interact. And this is also very important in terms of policy and regulation, using this eDNA for biosecurity purposes, as well as for conservation monitoring of populations over time and space. So as we can see, there's quite a lot of different types of DNA data. They're not all the same. And so because of that, we can't treat them the same. And we wouldn't want to reflect back to the researcher that they are the same. So we want to also be able to help them find it and understand what it is and the potential applications that they may have for it. And so when we've been out and about with the team, with the ARGA team, talking to researchers, we've asked them, how is it that you are finding data, and what are you doing with the data that you're getting, and how do you feel about it? And they told us that whilst they all go to GenBank, they don't necessarily trust what they're finding, and that that's a problem for them. So we said, what do you do? And so they have told us all about these idiothetic pathways that they use and the ways in which they have been themselves trying to solve the problem. And what they've told us is that they are looking, as I said, on GenBank, but they're also using other sources like bioplatforms, Barcode of Life. Some of them are using Emble. Increasingly, they're going to some of the other projects that are emerging rapidly, like Genomes on a Tree or Darwin Tree of Life, as well as other smaller, particularly taxon-specific project websites like WormBase or Reef Genomics. For eDNA, they might use something like Anemone or something like that. But the other thing that they do a lot of is they have to read papers and then track back through them to find the data that they want, particularly with respect to variant data, which is then locked up in these supplementary files in places like Dryad or Zenodo. The other thing they do is they increasingly are creating their own libraries that they can rely on. So we ask them, what is it that is making you not trust data, or what would help you understand the data better that you would then be able to trust it? And they have told us that what they want to know and what they want to be able to find are metadata for vouchered material. So what they want to know is, does this sequence actually belong to a specimen that we can find in a registered collection somewhere and get some verification around the taxonomic identification, as well as the location history? They want good provenance data in essence. The other thing that they want to know is how the data were generated. This is particularly important for things like eDNA, where there are a number of different ways that the collection of the primary material may have even been made, let alone the downstream way in which it's been analysed. So these are the sorts of information that they want to know that will give them confidence. So we thought, what is it that we can do and hope to offer to assist these researchers with this very difficult task of just trying to go through this massively exploding field of data? And so it's from that point that we have developed the concept of ARCA. And so the first thing we did was we identified that there was this need, that the researchers are feeling quite frustrated. We're now at the stage of trying to mash together different types of data to understand it and put together a product for people to come and test and interact with and see if it will answer their question or help them in their searching. And then next year, we're hoping to be able to take a portal out to people and have them test it and interact with it and hopefully use it to locate the data that they want to locate. And so our project is born out of a partnership with not only the Atlas of Living Australia, but also the Australian Biocommons, as well as BioPlatforms Australia, who are hosting quite a lot of very large genomics data sets. We have a little bit of money also from the ARDC to see if this is a tool that can actually be used to and applied to real life situations such as bushfire management and conservation. And so, to tell you just briefly what our objective and what we're hoping to achieve is, what we want to do is create, at its very most basic thing, just an index, a place where people can come and find the data that they're looking for in a flexible way, knowing that if they search for something under a taxonomic name, that they don't need to type in 700 synonyms in order to find it, and that we will be able to allow them to know not only the veracity of that original identification, whether it's linked to a voucher specimen or something like that, but also whether or not it's previously been registered under a different name, which does happen quite a bit in GenBank. What we'll be indexing are the reference genome assemblies from GenBank, as well as genome annotations, population sets, variant sets like SNPs, as well as DNA barcodes, and also more traditional formats of the data, which are coding and non-coding DNA sequences. Essentially, what we're hoping then that this will offer people is a sort of a life cycle or an ecosystem for the data, where the data are generated and they're also used. But by mashing it together with the wealth of data that are already existing in the ALA, it can then enrich those data and help people to then search it flexibly. For instance, we'll be able to use the species lists that are already pre-existing within the Atlas of Living Australia, which will help people understand the range of distributions for particular taxa of interest. So for instance, they might want to search for fishes that are known to occur in a particular environment and look for DNA data associated with that. We'll be able to leverage all of that information about the ecosystems and the occurrences that are already housed within the ALA and bring back records in a more flexible way than they can currently do in the existing databases. Hopefully this will in turn give them the idea to seed new questions or directions in their research. and therefore increase the overall reuse and value of each of those individual data points. So how are we going to do it? We've got a GitHub site there, which you can go in and visit. But essentially, we're leveraging all of the tools that have already been built within the Atlas of Living Australia and using the GBIF pipelines to ingest those genomics data from places like NCBI, where they're publicly available, and map it to Darwin Core. He's in the room at the moment, but Nick Dostromedios is our lead systems engineer, and he has built us a working prototype or a data exploration tool at the moment, and it's been built using React, and it will be implementing solar searching. We've already created some traits and facet filters so that people can come and just chop the data up into manageable sets. For instance, they can select all of the sequences that are from endangered animals. And this then refers back to those lists in the records that are in ALA. So far we have managed to index the RefSeq and the genome data from NCBI, also the data from BioPlatforms and Barcode of Life as they pertain to occurrences within Australia. We're also going to continue on with indexing NCBI to bring in the nucleotide data, and then do the variant data from ENA. The next thing we're going to start to have a look at is genomes on a tree and see if we can bring those data in as well to create a place where all of these data can be indexed at the one time. So this is our little prototype of the working model that we're using to explore the data. And what's really nice about this is that we can bring back the aggregate them by species then, and we can marry this up with the existing ALA infrastructure to bring back the images of taxa and present summaries for individual taxa, as well as being able to explore each piece of data in its own right. In this way, we're hoping that people get a really quick overview of what sort of data are actually available for any given species within Australia. So on some of these records, you can see that they're from multiple sources. They may have data from NCBI, but not from BOLD, and some may have data from BOLD, but not from NCBI, and some may have data from both. And so if we are able to achieve this within our two-year timeframe, essentially what we're hoping that we will have achieved is a very fair solution for researchers to come and expose their data and find it, and then also interoperate with other systems within the Australian Biocommons, bioinformatics space like Galaxy or Apollo or Next Tower, and analyze their data from there. So in essence, ARGA will not be a repository. It will not be an analysis platform, but it does aim to allow people to have a great deal of confidence and trust that when they search within ARGA under any given name or common name, that they will be bringing back as good a picture as they can get of where the genomics data are at for that taxon at the moment. And they may also be able then to intersect that search with particular types of environments and things like that.
2 minutes.
That's all right. I don't really have too much more to say other than that. The other thing that we're hoping to implement within the ARGA platform to make it more reusable and of great long-term benefit is to create a place where people can log into the service and create a DOI of their search so that it can be reused and shared and let people know that this is something repeatable and that they can come back and cite their publications for how they found their data in the first place. Just like to acknowledge the team that's working hard to make this a reality. And as I mentioned, Nick is our lead systems engineer. He's assisted by Christopher, who is our data engineer, and with support from Matt Andrews from the Atlas of Living Australia. Also working with us is Mock, who is a UX designer from the Australian Biocommons. And we feel it's really important that we have her as well as Kiva, who is our business analyst, in as we begin this journey, so that we can actually be asking a question that the researchers, or answering a question that the researchers have, and creating a tool that actually works for them and is something that is ultimately of use and benefit to them. That's all I have to say. Thank you. I'll stop sharing.
Thanks a lot, Catherine, for that lovely talk. Do we have questions here in the audience or online? Yeah, there is one question.
Thank you so much for the presentation. I was wondering if you could comment on the political restrictions that are currently in place for moving information about eDNA results, and how are you working to on this front? Thank you.
Oh, thanks for asking the question about that. It is a very difficult space, and we have not fully, our project is 4 months old. We haven't answered it. We have a mind to being able to answer it. And as you'll see, so far, what we have indexed are data that are publicly available. Alongside of that, we're working as part of the Atlas of Living Australia so that the taxa that we're representing are taxa for which there are some sensitivities around them in terms of whether or not we expose even their presence in Australia, and other things that may be endangered. We don't want to necessarily expose the exact geo-coordinates for them. So we will be using that existing arrangement, but we are in talks to understand the impacts of how things like Nagoya Protocol will affect what we're doing. But I don't have a clear answer for you other than to say it is something that is of concern to us. We were talking with some researchers from New Zealand who mentioned that for them the restrictions are a lot more stringent than they are currently in Australia where we are. And so I don't think it's something that we will be able to avoid having to deal with. And if anyone's got any good ideas, we'd love to know what they are and how to deal with it. Yeah, but we don't have an answer.
Okay, since we are running out of time, I think we should stop here. Once again, thanks, Catherine, for your talk. And also thanks to the audience for joining us today in this session. Have a nice evening, Catherine. I hope you will be around listening to other talks as well.
I will.
Okay, great. Have a nice time then. Thank you very much.
Just one session now. Next session is at 9:30. The seventh session.
Okay. So numbers again, right? Yeah, but we already went over some time. Now the next session is about we should stop this already. Has that because we're almost over.